One, two, three. Good morning. The peace of Christ be with you. Good. Now I've got your attention. Greetings. Y'all have all been so busy with fellowship and visiting, I wasn't sure I was going to gather us all in. Welcome this day. Glad to hear all of you sharing with one another and laughing and welcome each other to our gathering of worship today. Welcome to our visitors. We are certainly honored that you have come. We are glad you're here, and we want you to experience a very warm and generous welcome here at First Presbyterian Church Springdale. I'm kind of back myself and been gone. My daughter, the last of my three children, are married. And it was glorious, and I thank you for your prayers and my time away. It's good to be back. We've already been busy this week. You'll see things lining up in the hall on the whatever wing that is, going towards the rail room, classroom. We cleaned out the nursery and preschool room, and if there are some things there in the hallway that you could use or know someone who could use them, you're welcome to take them and those little orphans and toys and find a new home for them. So what else is going on? Let's look in our, you know, summer's winding down. That means Presbyterian Women's Fall Gathering is going to be happening. We need handbell ringers, so if you've been feeling the nudging of the Spirit to bring handbells, please sign up with Pam. Pam's right there, with Pam. Thursday Fellowship is happening this month. Also, young people, but not just young people, we are in need of technicians for our sound booth up there. You'll notice you saw Dan Cross working busily on these wires and trying to get the handheld to work. Well, if you have some skills in that or would like to be trained in working with our microphones and the sound booth, we could use your help. We're willing to pay our young people and give them a small part-time job. And so think about that and pray about that. If volunteers or young people would be a part of that ministry, it would sure help us a lot. Want to congratulate Nathan and Charlotte Medford. They're going to be celebrating next Saturday here at the church, their 50th wedding anniversary. Where are they? Wow, that is wonderful. So welcome. I do have a funny little story, kind of fits with our text today. There was a new pastor who had just come into town, and he began to do some visiting of his parishioners, and he went to one house, and it seemed to be occupied. It seemed obvious that somebody was home, but no one answered when he knocked on the door. And he knocked again repeated times and still no answer. So he took a card out of his pocket and he wrote on the back of it, Revelation 3:20. And he left it on the door and went about his day. Well, next Sunday, the offering is taken and he finds his card in the offering plate. And still, he knows it's his because it's got the Revelation 3:20 on it. But in response, the person has put Genesis 3:10. So he goes back to his study and he opens up his Bible and he just sees the two passages and just starts howling with laughter. Because it turns out Revelation 3:20 that he left said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." The reply at Genesis 3:10 was, "I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid, for I was naked." Gotta love our scriptures. Let us worship Almighty God. Thank you. know for many of you, she's just grown up before your eyes, and what a beautiful job you did. Thank you for that prelude. Please stand with me now for our call to worship. The heavens declare the righteousness of God. From the rising of the sun to its setting. Gracious and mighty God, we thank you for your glory. Grant unto us this day the fullness of your promises. Where we have been weak, grant us strength. And where we have been confused, grant us your comfort. And where we have been dead, grant us new life. For apart from you, O Lord, we are nothing. In and with you, we can do all things. Amen. Proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so with confidence, we can approach God, pray the prayers, confessing our shortcomings with confidence, knowing that God is generous and will be gracious with us. So please join me now and let us pray together the prayer of confession. Faithful God, you call us to paths unknown, inviting us to trust your Spirit's leading, even when we cannot see the destination. Countless generations have borne witness that you keep your covenant promises, yet we shrink back from your call, trusting more in our own limited wisdom than in your boundless faithfulness. Forgive our unbelief in your promises. Give us a willing heart to follow your call wherever it leads. Grant that we be counted among the faithful, ever testifying of your rich goodness to all who trust in you. Amen. God is merciful and kind. Be at peace, for your sins are washed clean by the goodness of God. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Last Saturday. Yeah, a week ago. So when I was out, Susan. Come forward. I'd like to invite the children to now come forward for our children's time. They'll gather here around the baptismal font. We also have a table set this morning. I saw lots of children earlier. Where did they all go? I have money. Money motivates all of us, doesn't it? All right, I'm going to make sure this is off. We're learning how to work our microphones here. Good morning to you. How are you? Have you had a good summer?
Yes, ma'am.
Where did you go? What did you do for summer? What did you do for summer?
I went to Silver Dollar City.
Oh, Silver Dollar City. Good. Anybody else go somewhere fun? Where'd y'all go?
Went to the Grand Canyon.
Wow, very good. How about you guys down here? Where have you gone for the holiday? For the
summer. Yellowstone.
Yellowstone. Did you go anywhere? Would you like to talk in the mic? Have you done something fun for?
I did something at home.
You just stayed at home? That can be fun too. Cece, you went somewhere fun, didn't you? You had to come up here. I don't know how far. Where'd you go?
New York.
New York. I actually saw on Facebook she played the piano on the street in the streets of New York City. Was that not, that's pretty cool. I saw her playing. Well, I went to Pikes Peak when I went up to Colorado for our wedding, and that was fun. I wanted to ask you, what do you love? What do you love? What do you love, Mary? You love other people. Do you love? What do you love? Who do you love? You love...
Oh, I like that answer.
Jesus.
There you go. That's the right answer. How about moms and dads? Do you love your mommy and daddy? How about your brothers and sisters? That's right. That's right. It is good that we love people and that we share with them. I want to show you something I love. Look, what do I have? A penny. That's right. I have a penny. I just love this penny. And I have one for you. You hang on to it. And I have one for you. And for you too, Mary. And for you. Yes, can you help help me? Can you help me, Cece, and hand these out to the children here, Sam? One for you and pass them on down. You know, I have this penny and I just love my penny. It is shiny and it is pretty. What if I told you that I keep it in a special place at home and I love on it every day. I go to my penny on the shelf and I take it off and I sing to it and I just love it and pet it every day. What would you say to that? What would you say though? You'd say, I'm kind of crazy, huh? Not kind of, I am crazy. That's right. That's right. Well, that is kind of the point. We are supposed to love, but ordinarily the things we love are people, pets, and we. Bible tells us where our heart is, there also lies our treasure. And so it would be crazy to just love on this penny so much. And that's what the scriptures is telling us, that we need to be balanced in our love and for what we value and what we treasure. And to treasure money is probably not the best use of our love, where it would be wasteful. So we want to be generous in our love, and we want to love objects that we want people to be and others to be the objects of our affection. And that's what Scripture tells us and would want for us. And so, good example of that. Now, what I'd like for you to do today is you're going to be going out of here. You're either going to return to your pew and sit with your mom and dad or someone in your family. Or you're going to go to children's time or back to the nursery, right? On your way, I want you to give your penny away. And you know what? While you may love that penny like I do, you're going to get a whole lot more in return. Riches beyond measure. You're going to get smiles from whoever you pick out and give your penny to. So would you, we're going to close with prayer and then I want you to go give your penny away, okay? Gracious God, help us to be balanced in our ways in which we value possessions and things, and help us to remember to value others and to use our love in ways that share the good news of your grace. Thank you. Amen. Amen. All right, go give it away. I'm going to give mine away. I want you to know I went to the stewardship committee meeting this morning and asked your stewardship committee for some pennies. They did not have one penny on them. That's the truth. So, let us look to God in prayer this morning. God of great hope and promise, we ask that you open our eyes to your presence here among us, that we may hear your word with great clarity and a sureness of hope. As we follow you in all righteousness, we pray this in Jesus' name, our Lord, our Savior. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning, we turn to the Gospel of Luke. I actually have not marked it. We're in chapter 12. I believe you'll see it on the screen. Verse 35. Actually, it starts at verse 32 in the bulletin. So Jesus is speaking to his disciples at this point in the text, and he says, do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, and unfailing treasures in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And then he continues with this counsel. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly, I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. For us, those of us who live in the South, we've all seen, from time to time, a roadside sign that exhorts something like, prepare to meet God. When I lived in Benton, Lane County, I have friends from First Presbyterian Church in Benton here today, and can you tell me, is the sign still there? Prepare to meet God. Big, as you go through Benton.
Warning.
That's right. Warning. Prepare to meet God. And you'll see crosses dotting our nation as well, bearing with the warning, you know, get right with God as well. And I have to tell you, I tend to relegate eschatology, that's the big seminary word for the study of the last things, the end times. I kind of relegate that to the outer fringes of my faith and my theology. I try to. But indeed, for the Christian, we ought to live one day at a time, faithful and loving, not be overly concerned about the furniture of heaven or the temperature of hell, and leave all of the speculation about the end times to others. Yet, I am confronted in this passage today by the reality, by the truth, which is that we cannot run away from the eschatological emphases that are in the Bible. Particularly, to be faithful to the Gospels, to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Because here we are today, confronted by this notion that Jesus will return, and we won't know when. And we should be prepared. This theme is presented in each of the Gospels by each of the writers. Prepare to meet your God. There's just no way we can really successfully, satisfactorily relegate it to the fringes, because it is still a central theme of our faith. We indeed must be prepared. This passage for today, it tells us that we please God more and more as we love more and more. And Jesus, from Jesus' mouth, we hear, be dressed for action. Other translations say, gird your loins. Be dressed, be ready. Light our lamps, stay awake, be alert. Open to him at once when he knocks. And the Apostle Paul says to the church in Thessalonica, we hear, as you learn from us how you ought to live and to please God, just as you are doing, you do so more and more. And this that Paul is saying to in Thessalonians is really not far from what Jesus is saying in today's text. He is showing how Christians are to live faithfully, expectantly, during this time of the church. I have to tell you, though, reading this text reminded me of when I was in junior high school. You teach junior high school, don't you? You do. Okay. You'll appreciate this story. I think they still do this, but back when I was in junior high school, it was a time, you know, growing up when boys began to notice girls and girls began to notice boys, and we would have those parties in somebody's garage, and we would turn on the music and we would play songs, and some of us would finally get up enough courage to ask one or the other to dance. And then as the evening progressed, and in my day it was 8-track cassettes. Maybe in some of you it was records, what, 78s? We've already passed CDs and now we're on to iTunes and MP3 players. But I assume kids are still in junior high getting their boombox of current day and gathering in garages or basements or the den. And, you know, somehow the evening, the lights began to grow dimmer and dimmer and darker and darker. And at some point, you begin to hear sounds like somebody might be kissing. That there might be some kissing going on. Then suddenly, boom, the father of the house comes out, hits the light, and everybody is shocked and scrambling, and all in that moment is revealed. The ones who have been kissing and the ones who have not been kissing, and, you know, I'm not really sure which ones were the most embarrassed. Jesus says that his coming will be something like that. Sudden. When we least expect it. And it will be revealing. It will show. And so we need to live in a way, in a fashion, that we would not mind having it all revealed. One of my favorite movies is the story of Breakfast at Tiffany's, What's Not to Love. You have that young heroine of the story, the hero of the story, kind of a mixed bag of and complex character and personality, but her name is, remember, Holly Golightly. And she has in her possession a calling card that she carries around, and on that card, that simple white card, has Miss Holiday Golightly. And underneath her name, Miss Holiday Golightly, is written the word traveling. We are all travelers, each one of us, through this life. From birth to dying, we are traveling. We move through the world on this journey. Holly Golightly in the story gives us the impression, though, of one who, in her traveling, she is running away from something. She seems to be trying to escape. But for us, the Christian, as a traveler, we travel as well, but not from, but towards something. The hope, the promises, where Jesus says, be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those waiting for their master to come home, to be ready. We are to live not for escape, but for purpose, to be intentional in how we live, to live faithfully, lovingly, generously. From the point of view of this passage, the present moment must be taken seriously. To live in the now and in the moment, and to live responsibly before God, for whom it is a gift to us. This moment, this time, this life, all a gift. One commentator said this as I close. We must be faithful, even in the little things, because there are no little things. We must be faithful in God's absence, because God's not really ever absent. We must live in readiness for judgment, because we are constantly under judgment. We must live in readiness for victory, because victory is a constant possibility. We will move from this time of sharing God's word to celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. We claim in this experience that it is a foretaste of the promise that Jesus has made to us. Blessed are those whom the Master finds alert. When he comes, truly I tell you, Jesus says, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and he will serve them. Each time we celebrate this meal, in the invitation, I often will say, this table, it doesn't belong to First Presbyterian Church, Springdale, Benton. It is the Lord who hosts this table. It is the Lord who serves us. And he serves us and reminds us that he comes to meet us, and that it is he who is our goal as faithful sojourners and believers. Therefore, I say unto you, be prepared. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks for this opportunity to gather around your word, to be nourished and fed by your wisdom. And now as we move to this time of celebration of this meal, may it be for us the body and blood of your, so that we are drawn so close to you, that we take you into us, that you serve us and are with us, you nourish us and feed us and sustain us all our days long. Amen. Please stand now and let us sing our hymn, God Whose Giving Knows No Ending.
Thank you.
be seated. And I look and see many of our youth are prepared to receive the offering this day. God has dealt with us in a generous way. Let us respond to God's generous grace and kind. If you'll please come forward to receive the offering. Thank you, guys. To you, mighty God, for your promises are true and worthy of acceptance. You gave promises to your people Israel, and for Jesus Christ, in whom your fullness dwells, he came into this world showing forth your glory. He was born of Mary, and we now know that through him, you share our lives. We watched and noticed that Jesus would eat with sinners, and because we see the way he journeyed in his ministry, reaching out to others, we know that he welcomes us, sinners that we are. We watch too as he would welcome and greet children, guiding them. We too see that we are to nourish and guide our children and to teach them to follow in Jesus' ways. We would also see in his ministry how he would heal the sick. And so visiting the sick, we know he heals us. And dying on the cross, we celebrate and give thanks and humbled by the fact that he saves us. And risen from the dead, he gives us new life. Living with you, he prays for us, and we are thankful. And so this day, we gather with thanksgiving, and we take this bread and this cup. And in doing so, we proclaim the death, the resurrection of our Lord. And we ask that you receive this sacrifice of praise today, and ask that you pour out your spirit on this food, that this bread may be the body of Christ, that the wine that we drink will become the blood of Christ. We ask that your spirit so infuse life into these elements, that you make us one with Christ and with all who share this feast this day. Unite us in faith. Encourage us with hope. Inspire us to love, that we may serve as your faithful disciples until we feast at your table in glory. We praise you, eternal God, through Christ, your word made flesh, and the holy and life-giving spirit, now and forever. And now together with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was arrested, he took the bread. He asked God's blessings. He broke it in front of the disciples, and he said to them, This is my body, broken for you. And in the same way, he took the cup, held it before the disciples, saying, This is the cup of the new covenant sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do so, remembering me. And so today, every time we eat this bread, we drink this cup, we proclaim the return of our Lord in all glory and praise. Oops. The gifts of God for the people of God. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord. Amen. Please stand and let us sing. Worship fellowship in the fellowship hall directly outside our sanctuary, and know that God sends us out into the world to accept the cost of discipleship, but also to discover the joy in following Christ Jesus. So go, but be prepared, and take with you the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the encouragement of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. And let the people say, amen. Amen.